Hello everybody, this is Licky Giraffe here with part 6 or 7 of my Dark Souls playthrough.
Woo-hoo.
Let me think, we're gonna walk and talk for this, sorry for the big gap between episodes. I've been playing Total War Warhammer the last few weeks. And so I haven't had time to put in any Dark Souls content. Great game, by the way. Really good game. I would heartily recommend that you give it a go if you like the Total War series. And especially if you like Warhammer. I like both of those things, so naturally it was a match made in heaven. So yeah, really enjoying that. What to say. What I'm going to be doing this video is, because I'm a real stickler for this sort of stuff, is we're going to be heading back to the Undead Burg, as you can see. And we're going to cross that dragon bridge thing, because there's a dark knight there, a black knight, that I tried to kill. Tried to kill earlier in one of my previous videos and got pretty wrecked. So I'm pretty much just gonna go back and finish the job. Jeez. Why is it that every time I go through the Undead Burg recording for you guys, I always do really crap? And I actually had to remind myself what I did in the last video. It's been that long. For those of you who also cannot remember, I defeated Havel the Rock. And I got his ring, which means that I will be able to put on lots of armor, but also remain relatively nimble. So we're gonna have no rest and climb up here. Now, one of the things, as I already mentioned lots of times during this playthrough, that I enjoy about the series is the interconnected levels, or sections really. Well, there's the dragon again. If you didn't see him the first time. It's interconnected levels. So before I started recording, I had to have a brief think about what I actually wanted to do in this video. And I also had a very brief think as to how I was going to get there. But I think that's a really cool feature. That this game provides. You know, you have to think. Actually, how do you do it again? Shit. No, that isn't it. Got him. You take the planning, but it's also because they're all interconnected, you're able to have a map of the area like in your head, and you're able to reason about things like, I could reach this area several different ways, but you know, I want to go this way because, you know, say the path of resistance, or it has this item of interest on the route that I want to do. And I think it's a very cool way of providing like the game world to the player. Now, it really adds a lot of choice, and the player, or at least when I play, I really feel like you're very much in control of where you go. And you know, so you might take a risk. Oh, so I'm gonna go this way. See if I can like can run past these guys to get here because it'll be quicker. But then when you die, you're like, nuts. You know, it was risk and it didn't pay off. You don't feel like the game cheated you by forcing you down that path. It's because you freely chose that path. and because you die, you know, you have to live with the consequences. Okay, there he is. Let's quickly get the hell down here to somewhere where I can actually fight him. So we'll do it around the bonfire. At least then if I die, I don't have very long at all. Okay, so let's learn some of this moveset. And it's got a very long reach as well. Let's get him out of that corner. Dun, dun. Ugh, ow. Ow, ow, ow. Yeah, backstab when used this. Take a health potion real quick before he can womp me again. Ah, jeez. What am I doing? This guy is just beating me up. Ah! Well, there you have it, folks. Me getting absolutely destroyed by the knight. But you know, hey-ho. Let's try that one again. And before I go back to him, I want to see if I can't angle these guys, just because I didn't like them. I felt they were too close, I felt it was like too easy for me to suddenly aggro them. So I had kind of hoped that they would come to me, as opposed to just firing into the wall, but I may not be that lucky. Where is the damn dragon? Okay, this was seemingly a bit of a silly idea. Yes, yes it was. It was a silly idea. I did not actually realize how far you have to go out to aggro them, so I'm just gonna call that a washout. And just take another bonfire, because I am a coward. Though I will kill this guy, because he's definitely too close for my liking. Right. I'm gonna try once, maybe twice more, and then if I still get really beat down, then I will give up. Ah, jeez, I love that. Aggro him. Sure, I aggroed him. Ugh. I guess the real loser here is you, viewer. There he is. Get out of that damn. Ooh. Alright, should take what, maybe three more backstabs to get him? So let's see if I can avoid getting whomped. Did not realize those guys were there. Totally forgot about them. Let's hope they do not. Oh no. I'm really playing with fire here. Gosh darn, this guy hits so damn hard. Oh, I really thought I was dead there. Oh, thank God. He must be dead now, surely. Yes! Oh, whoops, did not mean to rest there. Whew, okay, that was tense. But I did it. Right. Okay. So now the plan is. So yeah, last time I killed Havel, and I think either the episode before or that episode as well, I killed the Capra Demon and got the key to the underworld or the underbit, the depths, So let me have a quick remember as to how I get there. Oh yeah, best just go back to the undead burg. So that is what I'm going to do. Let's check the dragon is not around. Thank God. There he is, right on time. I will happily take those souls. So rest up here. We'll wait till we get back. Time to watch me do the undead. Partial undead burg again for the millionth time. Premier viewing material. So we've killed him, so yes, he's heading to the depths. Oh, unexpected backstab. Take that. The Black Knights are an interesting concept. I think they provide a cool way to add kind of extra bits of lore into the world. So that when you first come across them, they're very strong. They've got powerful attacks. They're really tough, but you've no idea why they're there. No idea. They're just there. They're tough. They drop like titanite chunks, whatever, and they're dotted around. Of course, I don't think, except maybe towards the end, you never actually have to fight one with other monsters. If you don't want to, I think. What? I thought I. Oh, wait a minute. Have I actually killed the Capra Demon? That is something we need to find. Ah! I love that. I really like the fact that they drink Estus Flask. It's wonderful. Because you always get such a like, ah, how dare you! Quickly, I must kill you for you drink Estus Flask. Boy, imagine what it's like for them. Oh. Aha, I have not defeated the Capra Demon. I have not indeed. And actually, there was a quicker way to get here as well. Whoops. Okay. So in that case then, let's do the Capra Demon. Alright, let me get psyched up first. Okay. not great. Okay. Yes, end up here, perfect. Right, so that didn't really go to plan. Probably didn't even look like there was much of a plan. So, the plan there was to get onto the staircase and then just kind of fight them all in one front instead of getting surrounded and beat down to all hell. As you can see, that definitely didn't work. I got blocked pretty succinctly and then just destroyed. The Capra Demon, I think, is a very interesting fight. I guess, like most of the boss fights, actually. It takes place in a very small room. And you fight both a boss and two of his minions. And a lot of people kind of find this fight really difficult. Hopefully, this playthrough, I do not find it that difficult. Hopefully. But it is a bit of a pain if you don't kind of pay good attention to your surroundings and like realize the strategic value of the stairs, or say the need to get rid of the dogs as quickly as humanely possible. Actually, I'm trying to remember to these guys up. There's another one. Because like the fight, I would say, is incredibly difficult if you do not defeat the dogs first. Like, they're annoying. Well, actually, that's it. They're damn annoying. And we've already learned thus far that you only really want to be fighting two, like one. Tops two enemies once in this game, and like the Capra Demon by himself is quite damaging. So failing to realize, you know, you have to kill the dogs first, like it just makes it really difficult. And I suppose it's interesting because it really does force the player to have a quick look around, because like, you're not even given that much time to look around. So once you step in, you pretty much have the three of them attacking you straight away. And like I say, the first few times you die, you're probably gonna like get wrecked almost instantaneously as they suddenly all just pile on you. Oh god. Oh jeez. Backtrack strategically here. Ow. Close one. How is there? Okay, there's a three of them. Three of them. Five. Drink. Head as well, these guys just take two hits to kill. Should probably try to upgrade my weapon when I get a chance, because even requiring that extra hit, the fact that they have a health potion makes these guys makes these guys tougher than yeah, the fact that they require two hits and there's more than one of them kind of really adds to the difficulty. So I feel if I do have a bit of trouble fighting the Capra Demon, I might I might kind of take a step back and I might just go upgrade my weapon a little bit, because I can already kill the dogs well, with one good strong attack, so that's okay. But even just getting to the Capra Demon, it's already taking a little bit too long. Alright, let's drink up and try it again. Okay, right, up the stairs. I wasn't able to recover my essence, but that's okay. Okay, there's my essence retrieved, and there's the dog's dead. Okay, get some health in us. Okay, right, now, time for a fair fight. Just trying to take it easy, learn his moves, his attack patterns, what kind of damage he pulls out, when I can afford to kind of regain some stamina, when I have to make sure I'm blocking. Ow. That's what I get for trying to play it cool. Those damn trees. And even actually, you can tell what's it like when he grabs both of his cleaver things. You know it's going to be a big attack, and rightly so it is. You want to make sure that you are blocking on us. And you know, kind of how the boss model actually kind of changes based on the kind of attack that he's planning on doing. This again helps the player track his attack types and what he's doing. Or like how, if he hits you or you block the first attack, he follows up with the second, and if he doesn't, and you just have to really just take your time. It's like, it's not particularly dangerous. Like, I have lots of stamina. I can block his attacks, but it's a big attack, and that has excellent tracking on it as well. So I can't really, I kind of just have to block that one. Let's get him away from that wall so I can move around him again. Oh, here he comes. Let's see that tracking. So it essentially becomes, like, I probably could dodge it, but honestly, I don't usually dodge. So I prefer to just kind of just use my stamina to tank it. As, unfortunately, boring as it may appear. But, you know, that's what I like about Dark Souls, is it has multiple different strategies. You know, like, a dodgy character would probably find this fight a little bit easier, because, you know, he would probably be able to have more opportunities to attack the boss. Wouldn't have to conserve his stamina so much. But then, nuts. That was a mistake. for the big attack, take an Estus Flask, and back to it. I see he has that jumping attack where if you get too far away from him, he jumps to you. And it's even more dangerous, you know, it actually kind of breaks through my stamina, so I have to make sure I do stay close to him. Because I can't block that other jumping, like, two-handed attack. So anyway, let's just get back into the routine. Take it easy. We're in no rush. You know, he's getting there. The last thing you want to do is kind of get impatient. And make a mistake, and then you die, and you have to do the whole thing over again, and it's very frustrating. So it really is a case of slow and steady wins the race. Don't try anything fancy. I should have expected he was going to attack again. That was my fault. I deserve that. It's also a very cool character model, actually. Really like his character model. Two more hits should do it. Here comes another big attack. We can't block, but that's okay because we have lots of stamina. Again, staying close to him so he doesn't do the jumping attack. And there we go. Boom. Capra Demon defeated. Key to the depth. Safe zone. So there you have it, guys. That is the Capra Demon defeated. So yes, for example, you know, if you get trapped down here, you're dead if you don't kill the dogs in time. Another option is to, yes, you get a pyrrhic, try to get a pyrrhic, kill the dogs here, and then try to fight them. Another option as well is, this is what for people who are really paying attention to say the very first fight against the Salon Demon, is you can get up here and then do a plunging attack onto the boss here to take off quite a bit of HP as well. I prefer not to do that because it would be quicker, but I never find that it's too unreliable for me to pass. I can never like get it down properly, and it just ends up with me, say, leaving myself vulnerable, and then I could die. And personally, getting the dogs killed quickly and without too much fuss is just too much of a plus for me. Okay. Right, what to do now? So, it is quickest for me to... We'll head back to Undeadburg, we'll rest, we'll get our SS Flasks back. And then I might call it there for this video. I feel like that would be a good endpoint. So then, and then our plan then for the next video would be to head into the depths. See if I can't try not to die against this guy. But yeah, I think that's a pretty good point. As well, actually, if any of you follow the angry DM, die. Or angry GM. I can never actually remember. I must really figure it out because it must be quite annoying if I'm using the wrong one. He released a kind of one or two very good articles recently about how to structure a session and do a recap for kind of role-playing games like Dungeons & Dragons. And I found them to be really interesting because it was one of the things that I had thought about previously. Actually, I just realized there I have 12,000 souls, correctly. So we could head to the blacksmith now, actually. Because we've only been, recording for 20-ish minutes, I think. You know, we'll do that. I'll do the blacksmith. But, what's the saying? Yeah, sorry. Really good stuff on how to structure a session. Because before, I would have always kind of... Darn it. I have to get this guy now. I would have always done a session where you just kind of play for say as long as your allotted time slot is, and then you finish, and you just kind of pick up where you were before. But he reasoned that it was instead better to almost do it more like, say, a TV show, where you finish, say, at the end of a major victory or on a big reveal, and how you should always plan to finish early. Because you always want your players wanting more instead of exhausting them. I thought it was a really, really good point, and I've already implemented it in the games I've been running. And I can definitely see the difference, kind of now that he's kind of reasoned with it and he's explained it. It does make sense for me. In that, I can definitely, how to explain? I just found that it really works well. Kind of really works well. It's allowed me to give a little bit more structure to my sessions, and now instead of just being like, oh, we will just play. So whenever I have a plan, so we're planning to defeat, or say like go through these three or four encounters, and then this would be a great place to finish. And the second one of his articles was, I want to pass straight across, is the art of the recap. Now this is something I really hadn't thought of at all. I had just kind of written a quick summary of the events of the last session, and then I would just kind of go through his bullet points, and then we would start. And I always did it myself because I never really liked the idea of giving it to one of the players to do. I felt that they could potentially miss important points of information, or it also gave me the ability to highlight things that maybe I didn't promote enough in the last session, or the players kind of looked over stuff that would be important for the session to come. And I was pretty happy to see that the angry GM kind of reflected some of my views. Two seconds now, I just want to reinforce my weapon. I guess I'll repair my stuff first. And reinforce weapon. Claymore. Hey, okay, we need one more Titanite shard, so I'm pretty sure I can just buy that off him. Just buy that, and then... Cool, so now I have a +3 claymore. Sweet. Doing mad damage. Okay, cool, so we'll head back to Firelink Shrine, rest, and then in the next session we will head on. I actually might as well just spend my souls here. Okay, so what do we have? We've got vitality there, endurance, and strength. I want a bit more health, so let's pump that up a little bit. So in his kind of art of the recap, he goes over how you should construct the recap, say how the start of it should be kind of reminding the players what their motivation and goal is. He goes over what, say, the end should be, where you transition into playing the game. How you should always start the session with something interesting, like the players making a decision. You don't want them starting off in a town. You don't want them starting off in a town. You don't want them say like, oh, I know. Do you continue walking along the road to the dungeon you're heading on, or starting with like a random encounter? He says, no, just kind of fast forward. You know, it's like you arrive at the dungeon. It looks like X. How do you proceed? Drawing them into the game, kind of make sure the session starts off good and quick. He recommended to kind of get all the admin stuff out of the way first. So, if, say, for example, PCs were in a city, then you know, kind of get all the, you know, like, oh yeah, like I buy X potions, I buy Y sword now, get it out of the way, decide where the next session is going to be. Hand out XP, which I thought was an interesting one. He recommends you hand out XP at the start of the session, with the exception being when you, say, finish a major story arc, which point you should hand it out at the end. I thought this was an interesting one. I thought this was a very interesting point. And he goes on to explain why at the end of his article. I won't go into it now because it would pretty much just be me standing here for several minutes explaining, and that'd be a bit boring. But you can go check it out yourself. I will link it to you in the description. So as always, thanks very much for watching, guys. It was a pleasure, and I will see you again shortly.